Now do you hear me?
Yes.
So, shall we go ahead with the questions? It seems you have given some questions to Narasimha Kumar. He would ask me the questions on your behalf. Shall we start?
Yes.
Yes, as far as I am concerned, I see no division whatsoever, because at one point of time the order strength was 220. It has been progressively declining over the years because we do not take any fresh recruits. The order is closed and therefore we do not take any fresh recruits. Those in the order, as they approach 30 years of age, or as they cross 30, they generally go back to the world, because monk's life is quite a difficult life, so many prefer to leave. So it has always been declining, and we expect that by 2014 the numbers will be very small, and then we will also be completely dissolving the remaining people. We will be settling them in the world. So people leaving the movement, we do not see it as a division. We see it as a natural happening. We don't expect them to be all their life here. We expect them to do good work for some years, and then afterwards they may like to go back into the world. So that is how we see it. We do not see it as a division at all. Shall we go to the next question?
Yes.
Yes, sir. The essence of oneness is, it is to free man from the control of the mind, to liberate him from the mind. The mind under no circumstances can bring about any transformation. It's all about quietening the mind and liberating yourself from the mind. The oneness and the dikshas are essentially meant to do that work. With the help of the mind, you can never reach oneness. The next question, Mr. Boss, shall I go into it?
Yes.
Yes.
The third question, apart from working in our connection with the divine, is seeing accepting reality and giving a lot of diksha. Is there anything else that we can do to win our process and to achieve the goals for 2012?
The most important thing for oneness is 2012. We believe that in 1989 there was an energy shift, which shift was made use of by several people to bring about a lot of changes. Like, for example, they destroyed the Berlin Wall, the Germans were reunited, and there was the Tiananmen Square incident in Beijing, and a lot of other things happened. I have met several people around the world who got completely transformed in the year 89. That was when the first energy shift happened. Now the next energy shift is going to happen in 2012. Now it's all about getting ready for 2012, because as energy shifts, we can make full use of it. Now other movements also can make use of it. People who are working in other fields like environment, healthcare, education, politics, anybody who wants to bring about a change for the better could make use of those energies. If there is electricity, we could make use of it for running an electric motor or a fan or a bulb. Similarly, the energies which nature will provide, not that we do anything about it, this nature's nature providing us that energy in 2012, it's much more than what happened in 89. We could make use of it. Whoever wants to make use of it in whatever field, he can make use of it to benefit mankind. So we want to make use of it to bring about altered states of consciousness, whereby man would lose the sense of separation, would feel close to one another. So that's what we intend to do in 2012. Now, how we propose to go about this is, first thing, we want to abolish the level 1 and level 2 courses. We want to give away these courses to the trainers. We want to train the trainers, whereby in their own countries, they can conduct the level 1 and level 2 courses in the way they want to conduct. That's the first step. The next thing, all this we want to happen in 2010. So when the trainers conduct their courses, people who go to their courses could become blessing givers. There is no need for them to go to Italy or to Fiji, attend a level 1 or a level 2 to become a blessing giver, nor is there any need to come to India to become a blessing giver. It is enough if they go to their local trainer, and with the help of the local trainer, he will be initiated and he will become a blessing giver. So this would cost very little money. It's very, very easy for him, and there will be thousands of blessing givers very, very soon. We want this to happen in the year 2010. That is the plan of action for 2010. For 2011, what will happen is, this is a growing phenomenon, the power will be so much that a blessing giver, if he gives a blessing to another, he will become a blessing giver. There is no need for him to attend any course to become a blessing giver. All that he needs is a blessing from a blessing giver. He also becomes a blessing giver. This should happen in 2011. In 2012, these blessing givers should form small groups across the world. They can form small groups in villages, in cities, in the particular areas, or wherever they want. They can form groups of 50 people, 100 people, or 200 people. They should form these groups. Then we will teach them how, it's a very special kind of diksha, how to give dikshas to themselves. The entire group must give dikshas to themselves. When these kind of dikshas are being given, what will happen is, everyone who receives this kind of diksha will start automatically growing in their consciousness. This giving dikshas to each other should happen there 2012. Then people's consciousness would so rise. If they are Christians, they would begin to experience Christ consciousness. If they are Muslims, they would experience the essence of Islam. If they are Buddhists, they would experience Buddha consciousness. If they are Hindus, they may experience Krishna, Rama's consciousness. If they are atheists, they might feel very close to the universe and the earth. So, people will be able to go into different states of consciousness. It will not be the same. It will depend upon his background, his conditioning, and his seeking. Since it will not be the same, we are not calling it sameness, we are calling it oneness. Though one might have a Christian experience, one might have a Muslim experience, one might have a Buddhist experience, all of them will feel very close to each other. There will be a oneness. There will be no sameness, there will be oneness. So there will be people who are filled with Christ consciousness, people filled with Buddha consciousness, people filled with Islamic consciousness, people filled with Hindu consciousness. So as this thing happens, as large numbers of people move into these kind of altered, permanent states of consciousness, it will dramatically affect the world. So even those who have not received a blessing, they too would start moving into higher levels of consciousness. And as man moves into higher levels of consciousness, most problems should slowly disappear. But these problems are there mainly because we are functioning from a lower level of consciousness. As we move to higher levels of consciousness, naturally these problems would disappear. So, the other thing we want is, we want the fading away of oneness. For example, if tomorrow Mr. Ball is going to do the courses, we do not want it to be called oneness courses. It's Krishna Ball's courses. He can take the oneness teachings, he can add from his own life experience, he can add his own knowledge and create his own course. So we want oneness to be to slowly fade away. That's one thing. And we do not want to control things from India. We want it to all be locally administered. We do not want any funds to flow from there to India. We want all funds to be only in that country. And we want it to be locally administered. We do not want to be some cult headquarters controlling things from India. That is the next step. You should not expect us to lead us. You should lead yourselves. You should have your own leader. For example, Cristobal, he brought the movement to Mexico. He's worked very, very hard for the movement. People like him should guide the movement in Mexico. We should slowly withdraw into the background. Our work done in 2012 will be around the years 2013, 2014, offering some help and guidance to stabilize things. And after 2014, we want to completely vanish from the scene. All the buildings here will become like museum pieces. we do not want to be any more involved in the work because the work is done. We do not want to become a cult figure. We do not want to take any credit for it. We do not want to experience any importance for that. Myself, Amma Bhagavan, and all the others, we would like to quietly retire and no more interfere with the work. My successors are not my son, not my acharyas, not my dasas. My successors are the people. The people take over the movement. They have oneness in their hearts. It is not a concept. It's not an idea. It's a living feeling in the hearts. So it shall live in the hearts of the people. They are my successors, and oneness shall live in them, not as a word, but as a real experience thereafter. And unless we retire and we vanish from the scene, that will not happen. That is the final fading away of oneness, probably to the end of 2014. So shall I move on to the next question?
Yes.
You have to start practicing inner integrity. That will be your spiritual work, or what you call sadhana. That is your spiritual effort should be to practice inner integrity. And the other is, there must be an explosion in the blessing givers. That can happen only if they can become blessing givers in Mexico itself and done by the local trainers. So for this, we would like the trainers to come to India and to get trained from us, so that they could go back to their country, Mexico, and produce thousands of blessing givers. Because when no money is involved and no courses are involved, there could be courses, but not too big courses, but a simpler course which is very powerful, then we can produce lot of blessing givers. So you must help us by producing lots of blessing givers. Remember, what is happening is, this is a phenomenon. This is a phenomenon which began in 1989. It's called either the Amma Bhagavan phenomenon or the Oneness phenomenon. And so far, for various reasons, we have been controlling this phenomenon. Now it has come to a point where we cannot control it. We should not control it. It should be let free. What is holding it back? One is the heavy charges. The other is so many courses. If we liberate the phenomenon from these two things, it will start exploding. So that explosion should result in thousands of blessing givers in the year 2010. And in 2011, as I said earlier, the next help you can do to me is the blessing givers, produce blessing givers. That is in 2011. And 2012, you must start organizing yourself into small groups, like the group that is sitting in front of me there, into small groups. And you must start giving dikshas the way they will teach you to each other and move into higher states of consciousness. It can happen in Italy itself and through the dikshas which you will give yourselves. And then after 2012, your state would continue to grow and to grow and to grow. There's no end to it. So let us liberate the phenomenon. Yes. Shall we move on to the next question?
Yes.
What is required to be a oneness trainer is, there must be great passion to help mankind and especially participate in this vision of 2012. That is the qualification. Next question. Mr. Bhashila, move on.
Sure.
Yes.
I've shared the legacy
My interacting with you like this is level 3. It is not that you must come to India, but then it will be nice if you could come to India. You could sit and talk. You are welcome. That's all.
Mi interacción como esta con ustedes es el nivel 3. No es necesario que vengan a India, pero si vienen a India sería muy lindo porque entonces podemos platicar.
Next question. Shall I move on, Cristobal?
Yes, yes. Are the teachings already part of the movement still valid?
Those teachings are my teachings. They are valid and I give them to you now. They have become your teachings. Next question. Shall I go on?
Yes.
I am not against anybody making money, a businessman making money, I'm not against it. I am only against spiritual people making money. My stand has not changed. I shall now clarify. I have said in my message, it should either be free or there could be charges without making a profit. Now I'll explain still further. Suppose there are poor people who cannot afford, they should not be denied the teaching or the blessing. In that case, you have to do it free. That's the first point. You can very well charge money from people who have money to pay, because if you have got money, it is good that you give some money for what you have received. It completes the transaction. That's why I told earlier, it should not be given free, because if those who can afford to pay, they must pay something to complete a karmic transaction. If they are poor, they should be given free. The third point I was trying to mention was not making money. By that, what I mean is, not that it is free. Making money means, let us say, a product costs $10. Now, if you can give it for $10, that's okay. You are not made any money. But then suppose you are a whole-time worker, you depend on this work for survival, for having your car, for having your house, for paying your bills. If you depend on this, then it can be more than the cost price, whatever it costs you to conduct the course, it could be more than that because you have got to survive. That is not making money. But then, if it's too much, then it is making money. So, where charges ends, where making money starts, I cannot tell you. That is your decision. You only should know where the charge ends and where it becomes money making. Suppose for a diksha, you take some $10 or something, depending on the country, it might be okay. So, but suppose you're going to charge them $50, and certainly it is making money. That should not happen. But where that border is, that may change from country to country, from person to person. He may have a large family, he may have to support. It could be different. So that decision you must take. Not we should not tell you what the cutoff point is. It's completely your business, your affair. We only give you guidelines. We should not poke our nose in that. It's completely your affair. Any other question? So shall I move on to the last question, Christopher? Yes,
okay. I would like to ask you something, as I asked you the last time we met. Just for the people here to understand and to be aware of how things are going to work. So my question is, in order to be able to maintain our office and pay our salary and be able to go on working as a coordination, shall we keep on charging the coordination fee until the courses disappear?
Yes, you can charge. Continue to charge coordination fees till things change. You can charge.
Yes. One more question, Dhawan. What would be the use of the temple, the Dhawan's temple, in these years that are to come?
See, Oneness Temple, up to 2012, we expect people to come and meditate here. And those energies will be beamed to all the blessing givers across the world. So that is its main purpose. So once 2012 is achieved, maybe 2013, 2014, it might still continue like that, people coming and meditating there. Thereafter, it becomes a museum piece.
Then after 2014, there will not be any possibility for people to go and meditate there?
Yes, there will be nothing more there. As I told you, it will be a museum. These people can visit it as a museum. As I told you, we must fade away from the scene. Otherwise, it will become a cult. So, it becomes a cult, Oneness will be destroyed. And Oneness becomes a word. That word becomes important, not the real thing. So, we would like you, the word Oneness, to go away. And therefore, you simply know something happened here. That's all. So, it will be just like a dummy thing. Where people come and go, they like to, like Taj Mahal you visit, no? There's nothing going on in the Taj Mahal, but it has a huge number of people coming in. So they can visit if they want to, that's all. But it will have no spiritual significance. Whatever God you worship, will live in your hearts. That God will not need a temple. Whether your God is Christ or it's Allah or whoever it is, they will live in your hearts. There is no need for a temple.
So basically, the power of the Diksha of Amma will come from
Yes.
And our work from now to 2014 will be to strengthen the connection that people has with God.
Yes, exactly.
And just the last question basically is, okay, yes. What will happen with the people that consciously or unconsciously doesn't want to grow? They just don't want to go that way because they can be manipulated or whatever is there. What will happen with these people that they are not really willing to grow in this process of awakening in the mankind? From now to 2014, there will be people that will not make it. What will happen with these people?
If someone decides not to grow, he cannot be forced to grow. You can't do anything about him at all. But by and large, most people would want to grow seeing the others, and a natural growth also may happen. And then he might, after growing a little bit, want to grow more. That's how it's likely to happen. There could possibly be very few people who would refuse to grow because it's such a joyous experience. It's quite amazing if anybody would refuse a joyous experience. It may not be possible. Our meetings for the present could be once a month. Thank you all so much. Love you all.
Thank you.
See you after a month.
Thank you. Thank you.